This video is sponsored by CuriosityStream. Get access to my streaming video service Nebula when you sign up for CuriosityStream using the link in the description. It's been quite a while now since the Abu Dhabi Grand Prix, and the anger has yet to settle among many F1 fans after the bizarre rule-bending race direction played out in the last few laps. For some, this is a very personal anger about Hamilton and justice, but in a wider sense, these questions are about the FIA go deeper and need to set firm foundations for all races and seasons going forward. And yes, the FIA itself has initiated an analysis and clarification exercise into the events of Abu Dhabi to learn and do better in future, though the results of this exercise are due to be presented during the opening weekend of the new season, so that gives very little time to set up whatever systems they need in place to feel like they have improved things. Nonetheless, the FIA certainly feels like its own reputation and integrity are at stake, though so far it has used language that gives the sense that it's more the audience's fault for misunderstanding what happened than the FIA's fault for making a mistake. One of those cliched, sorry if you feel bad, non-apologies. Nonetheless, the dream scenario remains this: a perfectly consistent FIA with respect to its stewarding, race direction, and rulemaking. You know, in a tabletop game, you have a rulebook that gives clear guidance over what must happen in given scenarios, and you follow the rulebook to reward and penalise players as appropriate. And even if you're playing by house rules, you keep consistency among how you play. It should all play out like an algorithm. If X happens, then do Y. And in theory, anyone familiar with the rules can watch a race play out and know exactly how incidents will be investigated and punished. In theory. In reality, it's a little bit more complex. So just how realistic is it to expect this kind of total consistency from the FIA regarding Formula 1? Well, unlike a board game, motorsport, like real life, isn't constrained by a limited number of actions. You know, in most board games, you can only move to certain spots, play particular cards, or roll certain numbers. In sport, there are infinite nuances of plays and scale, plenty of room for interpretation. And while you can box competitors in as much as possible, there will always be some grey areas or ambiguity. There may even be some rules that end up having undesired consequences. For example, in the interest of sport, you want to encourage as much on-track racing as possible, but you want to discourage actions that compromise fairness or safety. Allowing cars to move as much as they want, whenever they want, when fighting, is encouraging maximum racing, but this means drivers can just weave and block, which is unfair, or push the other car off the road or into a crash, which is also unsafe. The more you restrict a driver's ability to move, the harder actual racing becomes, as it reduces driver options in attack and defense. So this is the kind of area where you introduce qualitative regulations. Quantitative rules lean into exact measurements, like how we describe a car to be on track if any part of the car remains in contact with the white line. That's measurable. It is clear when a car exceeds track limits. Qualitative rules are more meaningful statements of value without an exact measurement. These could be like, leave room for a competitor, or if a car is significantly alongside, or driving unnecessarily slowly. In each case, there is no exact answer for how much room counts as leaving room, how far alongside is significant, and how slowly and how unnecessary is unnecessarily slowly. We have a good feel for it these days, for reasons I'll get to in just a second. Here, there is no black and white line between legal and illegal, but there is hope that drivers will interpret this fairly on the fly. Now, on the one hand, this does solve the problem of trying to give drivers exacting parameters that they can't possibly measure while in battle. If the rule says, if a driver is at least 1 meter alongside, you have to leave room, there's no hope of a driver in the cockpit knowing that. But, in theory, a driver can have a quick feel for judging if their rival is significantly alongside and if they cannot be squeezed out. On the other hand, this is very subjective. You have to hope that driver judgments are in accord with steward decisions. Which leads us to precedent. Once you've had enough incidents regarding a certain regulation, let's say leaving a driver room, This can provide structure for others to follow depending on decisions stewards made. Each penalty, or lack thereof, shapes the official interpretation of the rules so drivers know what is or isn't acceptable based on previous incidents. And as long as similar incidents are treated similarly from race to race, this goes a long way to cleaning up grey areas. While no two incidents are identical, as we hear a lot, most can be close enough to draw parallels between them and review accordingly. Now, one of the best parts of the F1 stewarding system is the decision documents logging. You can go onto the FIA website right now where they publish every bit of official correspondence from stewards and the race director. This is everything from incidents noted, investigations and their outcomes, as well as event notes, which include details, rules and geography specific to each event. And it's public. You can read it all yourself right now. Now, the decision documents detail the incident, the arguments made, the reason for the steward's decision either way, citing the exact rule under question. Now, I don't know how the stewards operate up in their box, but in theory, all of these decisions could be logged by regulation and filed with footage or annotated diagrams so stewards can quickly access them when making new investigations during an event and try and make decisions consistent with those that were made previously. As precedent builds, consistency should improve. So far, we haven't necessarily seen that, though the FIA have made clear that sometimes they want to change their approach to how they police certain parts of racing. And that's fine as long as this comes with transparency. And when we talk about transparency, we mean that the stewards or the FIA don't just hide in a windowless cave and do all their thinking and then announce decisions with no explanation. Having a clear understanding of how decisions are made is a key part of keeping trust in a legislative system. When there's an investigation, we want to know why, with regard to what action, what rule, who initiated it, what was the evidence, what were the arguments, how did you come to your final conclusion? And the decision documents I just discussed go a very long way in keeping race policing transparent and are maintained as a lasting record. Now, you could say the regulation documents are very good for this. You can look up regulations going back many years, and you can even read versions that highlight where changes have been made between versions. This is a really good start. Now, what hasn't traditionally been published are the technical directives that the FIA issue on a regular basis, whereby they make little updates to the rules. These are things like when they change how they're going to measure wing flexibility or when they introduce the minimum times for phases of the pit stops for safety reasons. These tend to be clarifications around how the rules are measured and implemented. But as far as I'm aware, they still only send these to the teams and they don't publish them publicly, which is annoying. Otherwise, though, the FIA arguably does make a genuine effort to keep all its rulekeeping transparent and accessible. So from this, let's talk about three tenets of a functioning, sustainable legislative body, which is what the FIA is and what the stewards are a part of. There's accountability, that decision makers, the race director, stewards, and even marshals can be, well, held to account and will themselves be policed to ensure that there is no rogue element and everyone operates inside the limits, the rules, and their purview. The stewards do all sign off on decision documents, but could they be removed from future stewarding duties if they make calls that are dangerous, unsporting, or inconsistent with existing policy? There's integrity, that decision makers will adhere to the rules and operate without bias or personal motive. And this is about not being corrupt, basically. But again, knowing we won't get someone with a lot of power pulling some shady or foolish shenanigans that are inconsistent with existing policy. And there's practicality. They need to have systems in place that are structured and operated in a way that allows decision makers to do their jobs effectively and fairly. So like a very impractical system would be having just one steward and they view the race through a smartphone screen and only have access to the regulations printed on loose leaf paper and they've all been shuffled out of order. Whereas a practical system would be having a team working together with easy access to lots of information, lots of camera angles, all the rules digitally, and lots of precedents of decisions made before them. These three tenets working together will create trust in the FIA. The audience and competitors will believe that stewards and the FIA are able to and will act fairly and without bias when policing the sport. So when we think about the current system, and especially some of the issues raised in recent years, where are the cracks we've observed that have lost some of the audience's trust? And as a quick aside here, there will never be 100% complete trust because sports have hardcore fans in many different camps that bring their own biases to the table. That's just what passion does, and that's fine. It is very hard to be completely neutral, but this isn't about winning over hardcore fans against referee bias. It's about creating as solid and trustworthy a system as you possibly can. Well, let's start with the race director. And this is less about Michael Massey specifically as a person, though I think he has made a number of significant errors in his tenure. I think this highlights more the problems with the race director role itself. I don't really want to make this all about Abu Dhabi either, but God help me, let's start there. Two issues people have with the safety car decision there is that only the cars between Verstappen and Hamilton were allowed to unlap themselves, when the regulations specifically say any cars that have been lapped by the leader will be required to pass the cars on the lead lap. And actually, let's just head off something here. Lots of people have rebutted this with the phrase, any does not mean all. Now, excusing those for whom English is a second language, people who say this are 100% wrong and have fallen hook, line and sinker for Red Bull's cheeky line in its defense to the stewards. Come on. If a sign says any passenger carrying a grenade will be asked to leave the aircraft, it means all passengers with grenades will be asked to leave the aircraft. That's how the word any works in that sentence. If you're parroting any does not mean all without reading the regulation or thinking about it, then think again. Okay, anyway, the second issue was that the race was restarted a lap earlier than the regulations allowed. And there's a whole other video on those decisions, but the key parts here are about inconsistency and fairness. Every other time, and at least the last decade, the ending of the safety car period, including dealing with lap cars, has worked in a particular way that is understood by the competitors and the viewers. Teams and drivers make decisions and go racing with an expectation of a consistent application of the rules. Changing the safety car operation in the last moments of the season smacked of inconsistency and unfairness. We don't even have to look at the frontrunners. Looking behind them, moving only those five lap cars out of the way meant that Carlos Sainz was unable to attack the two cars ahead. His old tyres might have prevented him from doing that anyway, but that's not the job of the race director to decide. And Ricciardo, Stroll and Schumacher had all made the same tactical gamble as Verstappen. You know, they pitted for fresh soft tyres under the safety car and were raring to reap rewards. But the cars they were fighting were allowed to unlap themselves, and they were not. So they were left looking very silly with nothing to do. The field as a whole was not treated equally when some cars were allowed to unlap themselves and others not. And this when the FIA has repeatedly said it applies the rules across the whole board, whether you're a title contender or not, whether you're fighting for first or 14th. Now, I don't think this was race manipulation or... Okay, well, it was manipulation to force through an exciting final lap, but I don't think it was a manipulation intended to favour Verstappen, to force a Max championship specifically. You definitely need a lot more evidence to firmly believe that was the case. No, for me, this was one man under too much pressure. He had a track to clear and make safe, a title showdown on the line, team principals barking in his ear, and just not enough laps to do it all in. And in my opinion, he panicked, and he choked. Despite Massey's performative demeanour on the FIA team radio, this was not a calm head. And what we needed was pragmatic decisions based on track safety and effective application of the rulebook, but instead, we had someone in a rush to serve too many goals. Now, we've seen this before from Massey in restarting a race with recovery vehicles still on the track and letting lap cars overtake the safety car while marshals were very much still on the track. It all feels like a rush to get things going. And I get it, to a degree, there's pressure there. You know, during any kind of race suspension or safety car, there's always a lot of, why can't we get this going? Come on. And the answer is often safety. You know, you're checking vehicles and people are off track and that repairs have been completed. And of course, getting back markers out of the way. You know, like it or not, that is part of the preferred regulated safety car procedure. So look, this isn't a Massey thing. This is a structural systemic thing. And as Brundle said, changing Massey will not fix the problem, because even if you did fire him, whoever you put in that seat will be subject to the same pressures, the same issues, and the same plate spinning that he's going through. It is a tough gig. There's also the issue of having a personality at the centre of operations. Michael Massey is now very much an F1 personality, and decisions he makes are now tied into the ego and persona of Massey, which is a hard thing to unpick when you need to act with a detached, level head. He should just be a tool, not a monarch. So to take the spotlight off one ego and make direction more about the system, there should be a small, clear team that has to agree and sign off on key points, like race restart procedure. Are the marshals in their safe positions? Yes, yes, yes. Then we can let lapped cars unlap themselves. Yes, yes, yes. And so on. And this ensures one person can't rush decisions on the fly. Now, yes, red flags, deploying safety cars, sure. Neutralizing a race for safety needs to be done quickly. Bringing it back up to full race conditions should be done with consideration and accord. Even if there is a race director of some sort at the top with two subs giving sign-off. Furthermore, there is something of a question as to whom the race director is accountable. Now, in theory, he's accountable to the FIA, but it is interesting watching the FIA manoeuvre when it's under appeal. It feels as if any pushback against the race director is a slight against the FIA itself. So the FIA tends to move to protect themselves by protecting the race director and the stewards. And this happens in many systems of self-policing, which is why it's quite dangerous. And foolish too, because actually bolstering integrity comes via open self-reflection and reform, where harm has been done by an existing system. So what would I like from all this? Well, I'm not that interested in getting rid of Massey particularly. Maybe the FIA will think he's tainted the brand, I don't know. I don't think this is a Massey issue, I just don't think it's a good thing to have him handle that job alone in its current state. Instead, devolving the race director position into smaller but strong roles that work together to bolster safe, fair decision making would make for a more manageable, robust system, even if there is a chief race director or whatever sitting at the head of it. I would also like clarity over Article 15.3 of the sporting regs. I know the FIA kind of whipped it out to essentially say the race director can do whatever they want, but boo to that. That is a ridiculous thing to say in defense. I think I have outlined enough here why the race director shouldn't be allowed to remold the rules into whatever they want to happen. That makes for inconsistent and unfair racing and isn't good at all for the integrity of its office. And the FIA is on a big integrity kick right now. So let's sort that out. And I think we need a clear and easy and understandable system of appeal that's independent of the FIA if the race directors and or stewards are thought to have acted badly. One that doesn't seem like bringing an almighty hammer upon the institution, but something that's deemed like a healthy part of keeping the sport well policed. The drivers and teams can make mistakes, so the FIA polices them. The FIA can also make mistakes. It's not infallible, so let's make sure they can be kept in check and that this isn't deemed a bad thing. And basically, all in all, let's remove the cult of personality from stewarding and direction and set up a system that just best allows quick decisions to be made in accordance with the rules. And stick to precedent, so when we flow race to race, season to season, every action is treated relatively equally. Or at least treated in a way that feels consistent, as consistent as possible. And I do think this is a realistic and achievable goal. And if you'd like to expand your pool of videos that both educate and entertain, where you can get swept up in a great production and come out with your mind buzzing, then you'd do no better than exploring CuriosityStream and Nebula. Nebula is a Streamy-nominated platform where many brilliant creators, and also me, have got together to produce and show content away from YouTube. That means no ads, no sponsor reads, like this one, and even some bonus exclusive content. And there are many independent creators on here. Some you may know, others you have yet to learn and love. If you're into technology beyond Formula One, Marcus Brownlee has you covered. Maybe you want more of the accessible technical explainers. Then the Up and Atom channel has a whole world of fascinating insights. And it's not just sciencey tech stuff, there are channels on music, movies, and games, among many other realms of interest. And many creators will give you extended episodes with extra content on Nebula or flat-out entire Nebula original series and shows. And this all sits neatly alongside CuriosityStream, the big subscription streaming service with thousands of documentaries and non-fiction titles, like Legend of Speed, a three-part series looking into the rivals, daredevils and dangers in the history of motor racing. Something you might well be interested in sinking your teeth into. And CuriosityStream have teamed up with Nebula to create one brilliant bundled deal. If you sign up to CuriosityStream, you'll get access to Nebula completely free for as long as you're a CuriosityStream subscriber. And if you sign up via my link that's in the description, curiositystream.com/chainbear, you'll get 26% off the annual plan, which comes to just $14.79 for the whole year, for both platforms together. And as soon as you sign up with my code, Nebula sends you a welcome email and you're off to the races, and you're helping out creators like me. So many thanks in advance.